Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Classical Conscience. Even though we're still living in a pandemic, I do hope that 2021 is treating you all at least a little bit better than 2020. I am thrilled for you to meet my guest today, the multi-talented educator, tap dancer, and percussionist, Aaron Grooves. You may recognize Aaron as the composer for the animation versus Minecraft short, Jazzy Note Blocks, or perhaps you've seen his highly successful live show, Collision of Rhythm, or maybe you know him from his very popular YouTube video, Super Mario on Marimba. But for those of you who are not familiar with Aaron's work, I've included links to all of those in the description for your viewing and listening pleasure. In the meantime, I would like to introduce Aaron Grooves. Okay, here I am with Aaron Grooves. Hi, Aaron.
Hello, Cindy. Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you so much for joining me. I'm so thrilled to have you on my little series. You seem to do everything. You're an educator. You are a tap dancer and a percussionist. And like, how many instruments do you play in addition to that?
I guess that's a great question. First of all, thank you. That's very complimentary. I say that I play, I mean, if I chose the instruments that I would feel comfortable like performing on as a professional, definitely percussion. That's how I got my start as a percussionist. So the entire world of percussion, which is so expansive, you know, I could say 100 instruments because anything you can hit, shake, or scrape is percussion. Right. But really, I specialized in marimba. I fell in love with the marimba in high school. And then I really got into drum set more in college and in my professional life. And then I fell in love with piano. I started playing piano at a young age, just kind of for fun. But then I got more serious about it a little bit later in life. So I claim piano for sure. And then the last one is tap dancing. So definitely tap dancing. I love tap dancing. And those are the instruments that I claim as like professional instruments. But I love everything. I love ukulele. I love learning bass. I play some recorders, some flute, a little saxophone, a lot of singing. Oh yeah, I should claim singing.
And I don't know. I'm just in love with music.
I'm sorry. That's such an ambiguous answer.
No, it's not. It's amazing. And I mean, I think the reason to be in music is because one loves it, right?
Absolutely.
So can you tell us how you got started then? Like, what prompted this love of music? Where did it grow out of? What were your first experiences that you can remember?
Great questions. See, what prompted this love of music? If I go back to when I was maybe 7 or 8, we had a little Casio keyboard, the kind that had the little yellow sampling button. And if you push it and say something like Aaron, then you could play Aaron, Aaron, Aaron on the keyboard. And that blew my mind as a kid. And I was like, what? This is amazing. And that was my introduction really to just kind of playing around and trying to figure things out. And my father is actually a pianist. I grew up in Kansas City, Missouri, and my father was playing organ in the church. He was also a jazz pianist, although he wasn't playing much jazz. He was mostly focused on gospel music at the time. So I just kind of fooled around and experimented on my own. In sixth grade, I saved up my own money to get my own keyboard for the first time. And it was a 61-key keyboard, was a Yamaha. And I've seen a couple of videos on YouTube where people actually break down this old Yamaha keyboard, because I guess it was a really popular keyboard at the time. But that allowed me to really understand chords, because I would go to the back of the book like, what does C dim mean? So I thought, okay, now I got my C moj. I know C dim and C aug. I didn't even know that they stood for major and minor and diminished and augmented. But I was learning, you know. And then fast forward a few more years in high school, I'm a sophomore now, and I want to be able to record myself. So at this point, I save up more money, get a better keyboard where I can actually record what I'm playing and layer it together. I had 6 recording tracks. It was amazing. And I started composing more. So that was really the kind of the fuel for everything. But in sixth grade, I also started as a percussionist in middle school band. And I wanted to play trumpet the year before in fifth grade. But, you know, we didn't grow up very financially well off. So I didn't really even ask my mother to play trumpet, which is probably stupid because my mother would have found a way. She's that kind of mom. But I just felt I was so sensitive to our financial struggle that I didn't want to stress my mom out. So I never even asked her if I could play the trumpet. Instead, she knew that I wanted to be in band. So she just talked to the band director. And then in sixth grade, they let me in as a percussionist. And the beautiful thing about that is that as a percussionist, since you have to play timpani, xylophone, glockenspiel, cymbals, bass drum, all of these gigantic instruments, they're at the school. You don't have to buy all of these things. So I could just show up there and play every day. And within 2 months of sixth grade band, I was announcing to all of my friends at the lunch table, guys, I'm going to be a musician. And it was like such a big deal. And then we go back to like shooting spit wads out of our straws. So yeah, that's kind of how it all started. And from there, it's just been music, music, music. Yeah, just shifting from one thing to another.
Wow. I think that's so cool that you just announced to all your friends, like, this is going to be my life. I can kind of relate. I mean, I wasn't as bold and courageous as you sounded, but I do remember this moment when I was 12 years old and I just finished my first solo concert with an orchestra. And I remember standing up on stage and just thinking, this is gonna be my life. Like, I just got so excited, you know? It's like, I wanna do this forever.
That makes me wonder though, like for me, that feeling hasn't really gone away. Like, you know, there's, as a musician, as an artist, there's always something else to do or explore or next level to get to, you know? So that's one of the nice things about being an artist, I think. I just wondered, do you have that a similar experience? Kind of that overwhelming like excitement.
Yeah, and it's on two different levels now. You know, when I was younger, it was just like, oh, I'm gonna do this because you're a kid and you're still looking forward to like your future as an adult and what you're gonna be. It's like at the time when people are still asking you, what do you wanna be, right? And then, but now as an adult, like I still have that same feeling, but sometimes it's, you know, sometimes it's when I'm in between projects or like I'm practicing and I'm thinking, oh, like I'm gonna be a musician, but it's more like, I mean, I'm already a professional musician, so it's not so much that I haven't gotten there, but it just feels like, oh, I wanna be this artist that does like whatever is blossoming in my head at the moment. And then there are times where I'm, you know, practicing and I'm just like not having a great day and I'm like, oh, I want to be a musician, you know?
That's refreshing to hear that someone of your caliber still has moments like that. Yeah.
I think the beauty of what we do though is that we can still feel vulnerable in that sense.
We have to feel vulnerable.
Yeah, it's not that you don't want to be accomplished or that you're trying to put yourself down, but I think, you know, being an artist is kind of almost about never achieving quite what you want. Like you're always working towards something greater but never achieving it. And my philosophy is just that, because if I ever get to a point where I'm actually satisfied with myself and what I'm doing and how I sound, then like I might as well quit at that point because I have nowhere further to go.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. I feel exactly the same way. A part of that too is just the simple fact that as we learn more and accomplish more of our, or check more things off of our musical goals, mm-hmm. change as artists, it changes our perspectives and it changes our perceptions and it changes our musical palette. As musicians, it changes our musical palette. So just the sounds that we're used to hearing or that we imagine when we hear another project will change because of the projects that we've done. It's like this continuing process of evolution that will never stop. Hopefully will never stop.
Absolutely. I feel the same way. Like the more that we do and the more that we, you know, like try to reach out beyond what we're comfortable with, it changes our just our perspectives on the art that we're creating and the art that we're listening to. And, you know, and it helps us evolve. And I wonder for you, how much of that influenced you to do all of the things that you do now? Like how much, because I don't imagine you wanted to become an educator and a performer and a musician and a tap dancer all at the same time. Like, they must have fed into each other, you know, at various points, drawing inspiration or giving inspiration. Like, how was that for you?
Yeah, that's a interesting thought. I have thought about this question deliberately, and I used to think about it a lot. Maybe this was the period for me kind of between college and having some kind of stable life of my own. I used to think about this question a lot because I noticed that around this time, since I was actually going more into the real world and meeting real musicians and forming new relationships and collaborations, I would see someone doing something and be like, whoa, that's so cool. I'm really curious about that. I want to learn a little bit about that too. And I would learn little bits and things from different friends. And then I noticed that I kind of came to this conclusion that if I had been exposed to something else earlier, I probably would have gravitated towards that. Mm-hmm. So I don't think, well, at least for me, that kind of curiosity and that kind of amazement with other people doing amazing things, it never really goes away.
Right.
So I guess for me, I just happened to be exposed to percussion first and keyboards. So I thought, oh, I'm going to be a percussionist and really love keyboards. But then when I saw tap dancing, which for me was Sammy Davis Jr. on some kind of television special, and I was just like, what? And I didn't think much about it. But then later on in college, I still had tap dancing in the back of my mind somewhere. And since the dance department and the music department at Cal State Long Beach are right next door to each other, I just was like, well, can I take tap dance classes? And that's how it started for me. And then a few years later, I was like, well, I don't want to be a bad tap dancer, so let me take more classes. Let me audition for some companies. Let me actually practice and not suck anymore. And then the same thing with ukulele, it's the same thing. And with flute, it's the same thing. And I'm learning saxophone now, and with guitar and bass, whatever it is, it's just like, I want to be able to use that in some exciting way. I hear something in my head and I want to be able to do it. And I may not be a virtuoso at it, but I can at least function, you know? And it's just an exciting process. And at this point in my life, I really don't know where it's going to evolve next, but I do know that I finally reached this place, and this happened maybe about a year or two ago, where I felt like, okay, Aaron, you can use the things that you've learned to make music now. You don't have to keep learning and learning and learning and getting better and trying to get to a level where you're good enough. Like, you have enough things that you're decent enough at to where you can really put some nice, cool projects together that you've been experimenting with in your thought process for a while. So that's kind of where I am right now. I'm trying to utilize more of the skills, and I've shifted from the constant learning and eating to more of the utilization and trying to produce more video content. So that's kind of where I am right now.
Oh, so cool. So I have to ask you, and this might seem like a strange question for most people, but maybe you won't find it so strange. Is tap dancing for you, how much of that is dance and how much of that is music?
That's a great question.
I know tap dance is categorized as a dance, but just from the beginning of our conversation today and then my own personal thoughts every time I see and hear tap dance, because the auditory experience is such a big part of it. You know, with most other dance forms, it's not about what you hear other than the music that they're dancing to, but like, you are creating music with your feet.
Exactly. And that's kind of where the lines definitely get blurred there. But a lot of my tap dance mentors and peers, and even me at this point, when we teach and when I learn from them, we always tell people that as a tap dancer, you're a dancer and a musician. And me and a lot of my friends and a lot of my mentors, we've been really focusing on the musical aspect. And the musical aspect was the aspect for a long time, but it's also been the dancing aspect. And what I mean by that, you take someone like, I'm thinking of people like Jason Samuel Smith or Joseph Wiggins or Sadie Young Glover, probably the most famous tap dancer alive right now. I mean, these are people who can make insane music with their feet. You don't even have to watch them. You can just listen to them dance and it just makes sense. It's like they're speaking language, just as a jazz drummer or a jazz pianist would. And sometimes they're even singing while they're dancing. I've seen this happen before. So they're just musicians at that point. But if you're aware that people are seeing your movements and you're aware that the physicality kind of dictates the type of sounds that you make. And if you want to be really engaging and really performing, you're going to think about your upper body. You're going to think about your arms. You may think about your facial expressions. And then you get to someone like the Nicholas Brothers, which they are just probably the greatest tap group of all time. Fred Astaire called them the greatest tap group of all time. He called their act the greatest video tap dance performance of all time. They're the group of people who were on the staircase and they jumped over each other and did the splits onto the next stair, jump over, do the splits down. Yeah, and you have people like Fred Astaire and people like the Berry Brothers. So I'm just mentioning all these names for anyone who's watching and is curious. Look these people up and you'll see exactly what I mean. Fred Astaire is someone that Michael Jackson stole from, like almost verbatim in a lot of contexts, just because his movements were so elegant. And so there's really, and for me, I started tap dancing because I wanted to be able to make music with my feet. But once I started, I realized how weak my dancing was. And I've done like regular dancing and trying to be like some of my favorite dancers, but not serious dancing, not like how to do a pirouette and how to do my arms the correct way, uh-huh. and knowing that opposite arm, opposite leg, like all of these things I had no clue about. And that's been a constant learning journey. So yeah, you definitely have to attend to both as a tap dancer, but you can focus more on one or the other. I'm just wondering, do you improvise often as well?
It's not something that I do regularly. I have dabbled in it, and I like trying things out. I always like trying new things. And I think actually improvisation is something that is extremely important and not, sadly, not taught enough in the classical education system. You know, they hear Mozart and Beethoven, like yeah. all the early great composers were right. expert improvisers, and yet they don't teach us that when we're first starting out.
I know, right?
Now I look back and I think, shouldn't that have been like one of the first things
yeah. we learned? You know what? I'm just realizing something, because I use this analogy all the time, even with tap dancers. We're improvising right now in this conversation, yeah. using vocabulary that we already know and putting it together to form some kind of a coherent conversation. And that's all improvising is, even with music.
Absolutely.
So, and the reason I asked that question, because I was just wondering, like, what goes through your mind when you're improvising? Because for me, it's the same as having this conversation that we're having right now. And occasionally, I may think of a word and want to use that word. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, because right. I know that this word really encapsulates the thought that I have right now. But that hardly ever happens. But it does happen sometimes. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'm playing marimba, and I think of a marimbas that I've heard of or seen before that I really like. Or I think of some image that I want to kind of project, and that it impacts what I'm playing, or even how I'm preparing a classical piece. Mm-hmm. And as a tap dancer, I mostly improvise, but sometimes I have a picture in my mind of a tap dancer, or I think of a certain tap step, or I'm like, oh, I love this maxi four thing I've been playing with lately, or these wings are really cool here, I want to throw those in somehow. But it's really just a musical conversation, the same exact as it is an English conversation. So you have all of the vocabulary that you can pull from at any time. And the more vocabulary you have, the more interesting conversations you can engage in. Mm-hmm. And the more educated your audience has to be. And for me, classical music is tough because in one essence, it's almost like pure vocabulary. But in another essence, it's not, because you're taking these compositions, but you're reinterpreting them and doing all these fun things with them and reinventing them in your own way. You know, you're making it you. So it's tough because it's like it's its own thing that already exists, regardless of what you do with it. But what you do with it totally transforms it. And it's like this catch-22. I don't really know how to describe that.
Well, to me, it's like the reason that I believe improvisation is so important and I wish it were taught more in classical music is not just for the ability that a student might gain to like come up with notes or tunes on the fly. Yeah. To me, a lot of it is also about our approach to music that's already on paper. Because a lot of times I find that, you know, like my most exciting and fulfilling performances with other people are ones that are more spontaneous. And of course, I'm not talking about spontaneity in terms of like changing the notes that were written. But it's just about, like you said, how the conversation is flowing. You know, the like notes are like words. So you might have words on the page that say, I am so excited. But if you're in a concert, like even if you're saying the same words every single night, like one night you might say, I'm so excited. Or the next night you could say, I am so excited. You know, like the way you pronounce the words, like the amount of energy that you put into them, it all relies on, you know, the back and forth between the other musicians, what you're hearing, like how you're feeling, what happened that day, the audience reaction. The audience, I think most of them in classical performances don't realize how much they are part of what's going on. They think they're just sitting there, but they're actually, I consider them to be like 50% of what's happened.
Yeah, I strongly agree.
You know, it's like, so if they're giving me energy, then I'm gonna give more because like I'm inspired by them. And so I think like with classical music, even if we have something that's already produced, like we still have to bring the element of surprise to it. It still has to feel like it's being written in the moment.
Absolutely. And one other thing, you just sparked a thought, which was when you were talking about the I am so excited and how to interpret that. Mm-hmm. I was having this conversation with a friend maybe a couple of months ago about how you could take someone that doesn't speak English and teach them all the rules of English. Uh-huh. And they could read an English poem or read a book and they would have no idea what it means, but they got it correct and they know the rules. But if you actually speak the language of English, how much more dynamic is your delivery going to be? Like if you actually speak the language of music and then you look at a Beethoven piece, you learn it in a different way. You see it in a different, you perceive it completely differently. I had this experience maybe 5 or 6 years ago when I was really playing a lot by ear, just because I was teaching so many songs to my students. And my ears were getting better. And I'd noticed that I had kind of forgotten part of the Moonlight Sonata, the first movement. Uh-huh. But I just started playing it by ear because I remember how it sounded. Yeah. So my kinesthetic memory had completely left me on this one section of the song. But just because I remembered how it sounded and my ears were so much better, I could still just play it. And it was like, whoa, this is cool. And now I've been having that experience more with classical pieces. But if I had really been schooled in just how music works, and they would just speak the musical language, no patterns, no relationships, no all of these things, and then learning classical music, it's more fun, it's easier, and you can have fun with it. You could walk onto stage and say, I'm so excited. Or you know that the audience gets you and you can say, I'm so excited. Or you could do different things with the music and people get it and they laugh. Like you can tell jokes with the classical. It's so many doors open up when you really understand the music on that level.
I'm so glad you brought that up because I feel like there's a big disconnect in the way people assume classical music needs to be heard or learned. And, you know, I mean, as a professional musician, like I value the education that I received. And to me, it's very important to know, you know, how to analyze the piece and how to look at the notes and how to figure out a way to play a certain phrase or like pick which notes are gonna stick out more and all of those technical aspects, you know, and then learn about the composer's history, like all of that academic stuff. But never in a million years would I walk on stage expecting or even wanting my audience to be sitting there thinking about all the things that I thought about. I don't think that's their job, you know. It's my job to know all of those things so that I can apply it and then provide the most exhilarating experience in the concert hall. But it's their job, the audience's job, to just listen and feel. And you don't need to know, you know, a deceptive cadence or major minor thirds. You don't need to know any of those things to feel classical music, to get an understanding of what the music is saying. You know, if you're just listening with your heart and then if the performer is doing a decent job of expressing the music, hopefully, then, you know, then you've got like the audience and performer and music all become one. It's like a trinity.
Mm, yeah.
And that's what it's supposed to be about. So it's like, yes, I'm going to study like my whole life. I'm going to study music my whole life and keep trying to learn and be better at it. But I don't want my audience to think that way. I just want them to enjoy it, because if they're enjoying it and not thinking about the technical things, then I've succeeded.
Yeah, I'd agree with that 100%.
So talking about like specific pieces, because you're already getting into certain things like Moonlight, I know you have several that you said are very memorable or important to you, so I'd like to get into
that.
Which one should we start with?
Mozart's Rondo, the Turkish March. This was kind of the reason why I ended up getting sheet music and trying to learn it on piano. And this was in high school, and I was in band and I was in choir, but I was also in musical theater once I discovered that world. And I remember being at a rehearsal and then hearing that music being played somewhere. I was like, oh, I love that song. And the reason I love that song, by the way, was because it was in a video game called Lemmings. And these little creatures just walk. They're just lemmings. They're just walking, walking, walking. You have to set stuff up to make sure they walk in the right direction and get home. And they don't actually walk in, off a cliff or something, or into a chainsaw or whatever it is. So that was one of the background tracks, just this little video game version of Mozart's Rondo, or Mozart's Turkish March. And I heard that music, I was like, oh, what is that? Where's it coming from? And I like, went backstage looking around, and there was a practice room with a piano, and there was a girl in there just playing that. I was like, what? So I walked in there and watched, and I asked her, she was already a friend of mine, so I wasn't like freaking her out. But I asked her, like, I love that song. How did you learn it? Like, do you have music for it? And she said, yeah, here it is. It's blah, 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 blah. She showed me some sections. It's like, whoa. And that section when the octave split up on the right hand. I remember seeing that section and just my mind just, whoa. It's like, I have to learn this piece. Oh, and I remember not understanding that Mozart wrote this, imitating like war and cannons, and I didn't realize that this part is like war. It's like cannons going off. So now when I play it, I really feel that. Yeah, I think originally I played it more like, but now I try to make it sound a little more explosive. And this part, oh. I can. I'll take that.
I love that stuff about Mozart, how he... Yeah, it's just like all this little like meandering things that just happen, and I love the lack of attention span he seemed to have. So like he'd be in one mood and then suddenly we're in another feeling, and the next thing you know you've got like these little meandering notes, and it's just like it's weird. I mean, it's awesome, but it's weird. And I love that, you know, you're talking about the canons and how you try to play it more explosively now. Because I think also the other thing that I struggle with is people's perception of classical music just being mostly about like relaxation. Ooh. And zen. And especially when it comes to Mozart, it's like all baby music. And I'm like, okay, that's great. There's a lot of like beautiful, intimate classical music out there. But you know, when Mozart writes something like yup ba ba da 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 da, I mean, it's kind of like bombastic, you know, and it's
yeah,
like
bombastic, absolutely.
In Amadeus, when he's doing the Turkish opera Abduction from the Scorpio, and everybody's shocked because it takes place in a harem, and then you know they're like singing da da da, right? And it's just like. Nobody really talks about Mozart being just off the cuff crazy because
yeah. He's
been so like, you know, right. Stuck in this little proper prim and proper classical music box. So
yeah, he was anything but like a proper classical musician.
Exactly.
He was just a musician.
Right. And he had tons of feelings and he wasn't afraid to express them. So I love hearing that, you know, when you get to that part, you're just like, oh yeah, all hell breaks loose.
Which of course is way easier on a real piano with a sustain pedal, you know? So that was my introduction to classical music and sheet music. And then from there, that kind of started me on my journey through everything else.
Okay, so one thing I want to ask you about, because it is Black History Month, and you know, I talk a lot about how the classical music industry has been very exclusive for pretty much as long as it's been around. And I feel very lucky that now I've met more amazing Black classical artists, but I feel like, you know, one of the many ways in which the exclusivity of classical music has been felt is just in the fact that there aren't so many Black artists who are in the field. And it's strange to me because because there's so many talented people out there. And I just want to know from your perspective, like, how is this, how do you think we can combat this and make it more inclusive?
One thought is a very challenging thought, because even if you're not a person who is prejudiced or you're actively working to keep it exclusive, because of the nature of its history and because of the nature of American history and a lot of European history, it's going to remain inclusive unless we take deliberate steps to change it. So this is not just a problem with classical music, which is kind of good news. it's universal. Even in the tap dance community, this happens. And tap dance basically is a Black art form. And of course, there are lots of white people that are part of its development. But without that unfortunate past of slavery and taking away the drums from the slaves and banning them from communicating in their native languages, you wouldn't have had, you know, tap dance. And the same thing with Irish, you know, Irish indentured servants. So with tap dance, I've noticed a lot that some of my friends that I love absolutely to death, sometimes I'll see a video they put out with their youth company and there's not a single Black person. I'm like, that's interesting that you have a tap dance company and there's only white people at your dance studio. And I don't say this because I'm not even sure how to talk about it. But the thing is, they're not racist on purpose. You know, they're not prejudiced. They're not mean people or bad people at all. They're super kind people. I mean, these are people who are sharing Black Lives Matter posts. And they still have an all-white dance company sometimes. And I just say to myself, well, the thing is, as an artist, we have to make money, right? Even as me, as myself, teaching private lessons, I can't just teach for free all the time. Right. But if I'm actually charging what I'm worth, then there's a certain community that's going to have more access just by the nature of the past, mm-hmm. right? So the only way that we're going to get more people of color to have access is if we deliberately say, well, we're going to make sure that they have access despite the fact that they may not have the financial access. So how can we set up systems to do that? Maybe there's a scholarship program. And some of my friends are starting to do this and they offer tap dance scholarships. I'm just using tap dance as an example.
Right, right.
I see it in that community a lot as well. And it's the same in classical music. You have to offer a scholarship or have some kind of a funding program, you know? And there's lots of people who are doing scholarship funding programs or have a grant or something like that. But it's definitely deliberate and it has to be done on purpose. And then the other thought that I had was that we also have to take it into those communities deliberately, because it, once again, it comes down to access. People aren't going to know about it if they don't ever hear about it. So I would never have heard about a lot of these things. If I hadn't run across that girl that just happened to be playing the Turkish march in the practice rooms, like, what would my life have been like? Because, I mean, I learned about Mozart, but I also got into Chopin and Beethoven and Debussy and all of these composers just because of that spark from right. that sheet music moment. So access. And when I was in fifth grade and the high school band came in and showed all those instruments, I was like, oh, whoa, this is amazing. What if that had never happened? I would not have wanted to play trumpet. I wouldn't want it to be in beginning band. It's no telling. I may not even have been a musician. So something as simple as just doing a field trip or putting on a free concert or saying, I'm going to give this show to this many classes you can sign up for. Or maybe I'm deliberately going to set up one class per month that's totally open and totally free. Anybody can sign up. And I'm going to send it out to certain educators or certain communities and see if people are interested. You know, I just But it has to be deliberate. That's the thing. I think that's my big, that's kind of the moat that I'm in these days. It has to be deliberate.
I think you're right. I mean, that sounds like what's absolutely needed, because even, you know, I just discovered for the first time, because it was going around in news and on social media, you know, Beethoven had written his very famous Kreutzer Sonata initially for a black violinist. And this was shocking to me. Why didn't I ever know this before? I mean, I'm a violinist. The Kreutzer Sonata is like one of the standards of violin repertoire. Like, we hear about the Hungarian violinist Joachim, we hear about the Russian David Oistrakh, we hear about, you know, like all these violinists who influenced great composers, but I never heard of George Bridgetower before. This just proves that talent and great artistry can come from anywhere. And to me, in a world of classical music where the people so highly value the quality of the art, and this is not to say that others don't, this is just, you know, like, the fact is, I think part of the reason why it's become this strangely exclusive club is because people are trying so hard to hold on to what they see as being high quality, and then they don't want it to be tarnished by anything else. But just the fact that it is so, like, valued and revered, to me, means that we should be finding talent and great artistry everywhere we look, and that means being completely inclusive. And just, you know, just seeing that, like, a great musician can come out of any community, from any country, any part of the world, any just, like, we need that. Art needs to be colorful.
It sounds like what you're saying is representation matters, and it does. You see people that look like you all the time doing this thing. There's never a question in your mind as to whether or not you could do that or should do it, or if you could pursue it if you have any interest in it. But if you see people that don't look like you all the time, and you rarely see people that do look like you, and then the people that do look like you, you discover that they're deliberately not talked about, and they're not put in the textbooks, or they're cropped out of the photo, like, well, what does that tell you? So yeah, representation definitely matters. And again, it has to be deliberate too, because we have to understand that a lot of this has deliberately been suppressed in the past. So we have to admit the history, we have to educate people on the history, because if they don't know, then they can't possibly fight against it. Mm-hmm. So we have to know the history, and then we have to undo the history on purpose.
Yeah, and I think it's extremely important to work on that. Also because, you know, music itself cannot grow without crossing and blurring those lines, you know, because, I mean, if you just think about how, you know, Mozart was inspired by Turkish culture and customs and put it in his music, Brahms and Bruch were inspired by, you know, Hungarian gypsy styles and put that in their music. And, you know, like, there's so much cross culture in music itself, and American classical music, as it began to grow, you know, took so many elements of jazz, which is essentially Black history. And, you know, like, so if we don't have representation across a vast number of cultures and histories, then how do we expect to make music at its best?
I say it's also kind of humbling just for me to think about how art has always been at the forefront of, you know, making, kind of fighting against systemic racism. Even, I'm more familiar with jazz history in America than I am with classical history in America. Mm-hmm. But I think about stories about how, Miles Davis hired Bill Evans to be his pianist for Kinda Blue, and people would give him flack about that and say, like, if you play like Bill Evans, then I'd hire you. He didn't care what color you were. He just liked that sound. He loved you as a musician. He would hire you. And he hired people from all over the world to be in his bands. There's a story about how Frank Sinatra, one time at a show in Vegas, they had the coloreds only, and coloreds weren't allowed to stay at that hotel. And Frank Sinatra said they wouldn't perform the show unless they let all of his colored performers come into the same entrance, sleep in the same hotel as all the rest of them. And that hotel changed their policy because of that. And all the hotels in Vegas eventually just let Black entertainers stay in their hotels. And he kind of fought against that segregation policy. So artists have always, we don't really care about, like, it's so ridiculous. We understand that your color, your skin color, it means nothing. It's no more important than the length of your eyelashes. Yeah, if you sound good, then I'll hire you. And it works in reverse. Just because you're black doesn't mean I'm going to keep hiring you if you don't sound good.
What you said, it's not about the color, it's not about where you come from. It's just if you have something to offer towards the art and it contributes to something beautiful, then that's what matters. That's what we're building. That's what we're creating.
You don't really care about color. It's all about the music.
All about the music. Yep.
Yeah.
I agree. Well, Aaron, this has been such a pleasure. I wish we could talk more, but hopefully we'll have more conversations even outside of my series and Zoom.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you so much for your time today. It was so much fun, and I'm so happy to have learned a lot more about you and your inspirations.
Yeah, this is so much fun. I can't thank you enough for having me on your show. And yeah, I look forward to hopefully learning more about you and throwing some more ideas around.
Sounds great. All right. Have a great day, Erin.
Thanks, you too.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, I so hope that you guys enjoyed that as much as I did. What a fascinating and thoughtful human being. Thank you all for being here today, and stay tuned for more information on my next episode. Bye.
I'm having feelings. Okay.
On March 24th, join me and the stunning Lucia Micarelli as we dive into the emotional depths of song. Can't wait to see you then.
Listen to that and just sit still. Like, have some fun. Go back, rewind that part of the YouTube video, and dance with us. Do it.